This week, PBS host and broadcaster Tavis Smiley joins the local show to launch America's biggest, baddest, and boldest exhibit of black history at Union Station.
From making office products to assembling Boulevard Beer variety packs, we take you inside Missouri's largest employer of the blind, Alphapointe, celebrating 100 years of service.
And meet Rita Blitt, an artist whose works are known around the world and whose design has been chosen for the Hyatt Skywalk Memorial.
Principal funding for the local show provided by Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kauffman Foundation, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Hall Family Foundation, Johnson County Community College Foundation, William T. Kemper Foundation, Commerce Bank Trustee. Additional support is provided by and Kcpt members. Thank you.
And I'm Randy Mason. Welcome to The Local Show. Imagine American history. If you extract black people from it, there goes jazz, there goes Martin Luther King Jr., Jackie Robinson, Muhammad Ali, Rosa Parks, Michael Jackson, Michael Jordan.
An ambitious and expansive new exhibit just opened at Union Station examines 500 years of African American contributions, not only to the United States, but to the world. 12 galleries are packed with more than 200 artifacts that chart America I Am, the African American imprint.
Along with the robe Ali wore as he trained for his Rumble in the Jungle, is Rosa Parks' fingerprint card from her 1955 arrest in Montgomery, Alabama, after refusing to give up her seat on a bus to a white man.
There's the personal journal and Quran of Malcolm X and the typewriter Alex Haley used to write Roots, and the actual dungeon doors from Ghana that held Africans captive before their voyage to the New World as slaves.
The exhibit is the brainchild of PBS host and radio broadcaster Tavis Smiley. He joined Nick on The Local Show with Peter Yelorda from Union Station's board of directors, who helped bring the exhibit here.
I see in the advertisements here announcing the biggest, boldest exhibit of African American history ever.
It is. It is the biggest, baddest, boldest
How is it that?
It is that in part, Nick, because no one has ever attempted to do this. That is to say, to try to tell the story, to try to create a narrative vis-a-vis a museum exhibition that lays out the contributions that African Americans have made over a 400 or 500 year period of history. That's a lot of history to put into one exhibit. So it's never been tried before. We think we've done a pretty good job of telling that story, but it's a massive undertaking.
Now, you're on the board of directors of Union Station, Peter Yelorda. You've been through it. You helped bring the exhibit here. What will people see that they haven't seen before in Kansas City?
They will see history laid out in such a way that it, you know, from the slave leaving Africa, the whole journey into America, and then the American experience, and the effect of that experience on this country and the development of this country.
You know, most people on our audience just see you as the late night talk show host on Tavis Smiley. Yeah. What, you know, they don't see Charlie Rose going out doing museum exhibitions on science or on international politics. Why did you get into this sort of museum exhibition gig to begin with?
Because I'm working like a Jamaican. That's why I've got like 8 or 9 jobs. We do books, of course. We do radio. We do television. We have a speakers bureau.
Do you sleep, Tavis?
I do. About 4 or 5 hours a night. But the bottom line, the honest answer to your question, Nick, is simply this. I believe, as my granddad said to me many times, you can sleep when you die. You can rest when you die. And whatever gift and skill and talent God has blessed me with, I want to be all used up whenever my time comes, which I hope is no time soon. But I really enjoy loving and serving people. And I'm always trying to find ways to inspire people, to enlighten people, to empower people, try to get folks to re-examine the assumptions they hold, helping people expand their inventory of ideas, using the platforms I've been blessed to have to introduce Americans to each other. The bottom line is I love people, and I think that leadership is just that. You can't lead people unless you love people. You can't save people unless you serve people. So leadership is about loving and serving people, and I find joy. I really get joy out of loving and serving people.
Let's talk about some of the exhibits. We have Prince's purple guitar. Mm-hmm. We have Michael Jordan items in there, Muhammad Ali's robe. What else will people get to see, Peter?
I was very impressed in seeing Gregory Hines' shoes, you know, the great
tap shoes.
His tap shoes, you know, some call it tap, some call it hoofing. And I saw Gregory Hines when he performed here in Kansas City not long before he passed. And so I was just thrilled to see that as a part of the collection and the diversity of the collection because, and each theme of the items hit upon a part of the American experience. The African American experience that really contributes to this country being what it is.
Now, it's oftentimes, of course, parents or grandparents who drag their kids along to go to see a museum, and the kids don't really want to go. Mm-hmm. What is there for kids to see in this, and is there any buttons to push or to, in some way to get kids engaged
in
this experience?
It's a great question, Nick. It's terribly interactive, number one. There's video. There are, of course, actual artifacts. There's light. There's sound. And for the kids who read about this, the part of Black history that they do read, which because not enough of it's being taught in school, but for the part of history that they do read, to see their eyes light up when this history comes to life is amazing. So this is really one of those rare things. This is not just, you know, selling this exhibit. It really is true that there are so few things that these days you can take the entire family to and they're all going to enjoy it. Whether they're 8 or 80, you will not be disappointed in this exhibit because when you talk about Black history, there's so much there. So there's Tupac Shakur stuff. These kids all love Tupac's music. There are handwritten lyrics by Tupac. There's stuff in there from Venus and Serena. There's music, there's art, there's culture. Every aspect of the human endeavor that Black people have engaged in is covered in this exhibit. So kids are going to enjoy it, adults are going to enjoy it, and the ticket price for this exhibit, you can't see a movie in Kansas City for the price of this ticket. So it's really, really affordable, and we did that deliberately, and the Union Station people were good with us, helping us to set the price that makes it affordable for everybody in Kansas City.
And that's $12 for adults, $8 for children.
That's right.
$5 for Union Station members.
Right.
I would get physically harmed if I didn't mention that. But I will say, if you're a Kcpt member, there's $4 off a ticket price. How about that?
I like that.
We've failed to mention, though, one of the most emotional parts of the exhibit, Peter, and that's the Gates of No Return.
Yes. Very moving. As Tavis explained the significance and the history of the gates, you know, I made a comment to him that it's very interesting. It was through those gates that our ancestors passed to come to this country. And now those gates have made the same journey mm-hmm. to this country that our ancestors made. You know, and there's a lot of irony in that for me, at least.
And these doors, as Peter's referencing that you ask about, Nick, they're the Doors of No Return, built in 1653. And they're on loan to the exhibit from the country of Ghana. When I was just a kid, my very first trip to Africa, I was taken to Africa by Maya Angelou. And I was just a kid. I carried her bags around Africa for 2 or 3 weeks and just spent time learning literally at her feet from Dr. Angelou. When we were in Africa together, I went to stand in the Door of No Return while I was in Ghana. And imagine now 25 years later or so, these doors are actually on display in Kansas City. But it's the most, to your point, it's the most powerful, one of the most powerful pieces of the exhibit, Nick, because this is the one thing that we all have in common. All of our ancestors had to walk through this door unwittingly, unwillingly. Millions died, as you know, in the Middle Passage trying to make it to America. But they all walked through this door of no return. And so for those who've never even been to Africa, I tell you, when you stand in those doors at this exhibit, you feel a power, you feel a presence, a resonance with these doors from 1653 being in Kansas City. So there's a lot of great items in the exhibit that cover Dr. King and Malcolm X and Rosa Parks and all the pop culture that you referenced earlier. But those doors really move pretty much everybody.
You said that was on loan, but all of these items, none of these things
belong
to you.
Exactly.
You had to beg and scrounge
for
these items.
That's right.
I mean, even from these celebrities, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. I did a lot of begging, a lot of asking.
Tell us about that.
About you all, the funny story about the begging is, so we wanted an item from Prince. So Prince happens to be a good friend of mine. So I called Prince.
As one would be.
Well, no. I'm just answering. You ask. I'm not name dropping, but let me pick that up.
Yeah.
But anyway, so I called Prince because they wanted a Prince item. So I said to Prince, I'm doing this art exhibit, and I want to get something from you. He said, what do you think? I said, well, how about like the guitar from Purple Rain? And he paused and he said, well, come by and get it. I said, just come and get it? He said, yeah, just come to the house and get it. So I got in my car, rode over to his house, and I got it. And so I'm standing there at this guitar, and of course, like anybody else, it's like risky business. When I got home, I'm in the floor. And I'm playing this guitar. I got pictures of myself playing Prince's guitar. My friends come by, I let them see Prince's guitar. We're all doing this. Yes. And then the art curators come to my house to actually get the guitar. Now, we've been acting a fool with this guitar running around my house. Yes. They come with white gloves.
Yes.
and boxes to pack it in. And they're like, they're hailing this thing like it's priceless, because it is priceless. But I got a chance to make a bunch of phone calls to get a lot of items. But I will tell you this, Nick, that nobody, I can't think of maybe one or two persons, but almost nobody said no. When people understood what the exhibit was, Peter, what we were trying to do, you didn't have to really beg anybody. I had to ask. But when they understood what it was, everybody loaned these items, and that's why there are almost 300 items in this exhibit on loan, as I said earlier, from around the world. And to your point, finally, it is sad that when this exhibit finally ends, and we're only traveling 4 years, we're only going to 10 cities, so I hope Kansas City feels really proud of the fact that they made the cut of one of these 10 cities. But when it's all said and done, these items, they don't get to go home with me. I wish they could, but they go back to all the people who loaned them to us.
America I Am runs through January 8th mm-hmm. right here in Kansas City. All the details of that exhibit you can see on our website at thelocalshow.org. Peter Yelorda of the Board of Directors of Union Station, Tavis Smiley, thank you so much for being with us. We're going to see you later tonight on
Kcpt. And Nick of South Wales.
Good to see you. I'm already taking tips from you. I sit on the edge of my chair.
You do on your show. You need no help from me.
Alrighty.
So you know what? You sit on the edge of your chair. When I get back, I'm going to try to do that accent.
You will? Alrighty. That's all right. A deal. Good to see you. Thanks so much for being with us on the Local Show.
Next on the Local Show, from making office products to assembling Boulevard Beer variety packs, we take you inside Missouri's largest employer of the blind. How much do you know about Alphapointe? The Kansas City-based nonprofit has been offering job opportunities for the visually impaired since 1911. What started as the Kansas City Association of Blind Workers is now celebrating its centennial. Video journalist Rich Miller has this Kansas City difference maker profile.
Well, Alphapointe Association for the Blind is the largest employer of people who are blind in the state of Missouri and the only provider of comprehensive rehabilitation services throughout the state. We serve about 800 people a year. We were formed in 1911, founded by a lady by the name of Catherine Hale, whose brother was blind, and she wanted to create opportunities for him. Ms. Hale was looking for what were the needs that people who are blind had in the community. And one of them, obviously, very quickly, was employment, to be able to earn their own living and be able to provide for themselves and for their families. So they started out making brooms. And then in the 1960s, we started producing pens for the government. And then later on, through a partnership with 3M, we've more recently added tape, which we slit and sell to the government. And then injection molding, providing prescription bottles to the Department of Veterans Affairs, so that a veteran who needs their prescription, any veteran across the country that needs their prescription, is going to receive that prescription in a bottle manufactured here by people who are blind at Alphapointe.
They're always surprised when I mention the beer, that we're doing this for Boulevard Brewing Company. I had experienced a brain tumor and was successfully operated on, but I had always been self-employed, and things have changed. The medical condition in this, my health insurance was just out of sight.
Well, my goal is to be the best employee wherever they put me. I know people didn't think I could do much as a child. The school didn't think I'd be able to hold down a job when I became an adult. I didn't get out of there till I was 20. And when I first got my job, one of my teachers down there at the school says, what, that kid can't work? So I still kind of laugh at that a little bit.
So it just kind of, keep you going, and you don't kind of too much look at your eyesight as something, bad. It could be, something good, because all of your other independents kind of pick up, like my ear sight, your smell and things of that nature. You kind of like take that over from my vision.
I think we got a ways to go, because we've never been able to get under the 70% unemployment rate. So that's exactly why I came down, because I knew had I stayed up in Iowa, I might not have worked again. And I was too young to retire at 50. I'm 62, and people ask me when I'm going to retire now. I still feel like I'm too young, so there you go.
Is it better without that, or is it better with this?
Retinitis pigmentosa. I'm slowly losing my central and peripheral vision. It's like a, it's like looking through a straw. And eventually, over time, it can. They're not really sure if it'll happen to everybody, but you're totally lose all vision. Because I was always thinking about one day I might wake up and be blind, and how would I deal with that?
Alphapointe Low Vision Clinic is a place where they can come and get back in the mainstream of life. We'll take what they have to use and help them to use it best. We can't make poor retinas good again, but we can take poor skills and make them better. And we can show people how they can do things, maybe in a different way, but still get the job done that they couldn't do before. We like to think that, you know, we're helping people get over the bar in life. I mean, sometimes circumstances have set that bar pretty high. We can't pull them over the bar, but we'll show them how to get over it.
Basically, I try and be proactive. So when I do wake up that day, that I'm prepared and not scared to death. Because that's a lot of emotional stress.
Alphapointe provides services for people of all ages with vision loss, from birth to seniors. Alphapointe services are designed to lead folks to independence. We provide them with tools, with equipment, and with skills to function in a sighted world and live independently. Throughout our history, we've dedicated a lot of resources to the working age population. In recent years, we've really grown our services to seniors. And more recently, this last summer, we initiated two camps for young people. Alphapointe Adventure Camp was designed to challenge young kids who are blind. They got to fish, they got to swim, they got to canoe and climb rock walls and do things that most of these students had not done before. And they were really challenged outside of their comfort zone and loved it, had a good time, and made friends that we hope will last a lifetime.
In 2000, we began a capital campaign, and we secured funding from the community, and a lot of the names that are on this wall are important for us. And they helped us buy this property and construct this building.
The old building, it was so cramped, and things I remember being blind, working with being in transportation, when you rode the cabs, they dropped you right off on 20th Street, which is a very busy street going to the highway. This building out here at 75th and Prospect, the area is a lot better to get to. It's more centrally located. It's safe to get out and in vehicles. It's one level, plenty of spaciousness, and more friendly to blind people with the different textures on the floor.
A lot of people, including myself, I was losing confidence thinking that nobody would hire me. How am I gonna get another job? And coming here and knowing that there's a lot of technology out there and they will teach you all these things and skills that I can go out there and get a job.
Thousands of educational and employment opportunities that you know weren't available at one time are now available. It's absolutely phenomenal to have access to email, any information on the internet, and even portable devices. Certain types of consumer electronics, like cell phones, that speak what's on their screens, or in some cases magnify as well.
So the real question is, why does this all matter? 70% of people who are blind are unemployed across our country. It's a great group of people who want to work. They have the capability to do anything that is put in front of them if they're just given the chance. And places like Alphapointe provide for those opportunities to build on those skills and then to be able to go into the community and make a meaningful contribution to society.
Alphapointe marks its 100th birthday with a special celebration featuring the five-time Grammy Award winners, the Blind Boys of Alabama, at the Midland Theater on November 12th. For more details on Alphapointe and their 100th birthday bash at the Midland, visit thelocalshow.org.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
There's nothing unusual about art exhibitions around town. They're a big part of Kansas City's cultural life. But it isn't often that one artist is featured in three shows at the same time. That's what happened this fall when Rita Blitt had three shows underway at Longview and Penn Valley Community Colleges, as well as in the gallery at Central Missouri University in Warrensburg. Randy Mason caught up with this Kansas City favorite just down the street at the Carter Art Center.
Most all my life, I've let lines flow spontaneously. In the 90s, I made a very conscious decision that I wanted to paint more to music. This particular group, I decided not to have music, to go back to what I used to do, just let lines flow from me, from the gut. I call these the sacred moment because it felt like they were done just in a moment. I did one after another, just as fast as I could get the paper off the canvas and put it up and paint another and another and another till I was out of canvas. Those over there are dancing lines, and those are dancing lines. The sculptures come completely directly from my dancing lines. I go through my lines to see which drawing would make a good sculpture.
Rita Blitt has been pursuing the line in different ways, in different media, for decades. Each of the three recent exhibitions illuminates a different aspect of Rita's own art history. In Warrensburg, the focus was on paintings spurred by the Gulf War in the 1990s. The show at Longview reaches all the way back to the 70s. To a fertile period of creativity that amazes her still.
I went out and bought six drawing pads, 18 by 24, and I just let them flow. And when those drawing pads were gone, then I was ready for more paper. I really didn't know how it was happening or where it was coming from, and I was fascinated. I wanted to keep letting it happen. Those initial drawings, very important. One of them became a sculpture 60 feet tall. You know, as I'm cataloging my work now, it's quite amazing and thrilling to note what's come out of me. Where did it come from?
Whatever the source, what's remained constant throughout it all, she says, has been enjoyment. Fun, fueled by moving from challenge to challenge. Monumental sculptures meant working with fabricators, then structural engineers. But film has required the most teamwork of all. Recent pieces, like Blur, and collaborating with the past, have literally set Rita's lines in motion.
I think we both love to work spontaneously.
It's a fascination that began in 2003 when she teamed up with dancer and native Kansas Cityan David Parsons for Caught in Paint.
I put myself in front of the surface on which I'm going to paint, and I very often close my eyes. Caught in Paint started getting into film festivals. Everybody was claiming in the festival what their role was, and I guess most everybody was a director, and it got to me, and I couldn't say those words. I was the director. I couldn't claim it. I couldn't claim ownership because there were so many people involved. And now it's easier.
The layout of things, the way that your works are shown, probably not just a random happenstance thing.
No, I agonize over each exhibit. I organize it, and then I organize it, and then I organize it again. It's just awful. It really is. I thought I had all three shows really finalized, everything last May. I was gonna have total relaxation over the summer, and I was kidding myself. I am a perfectionist, I admit, and I guess I'm glad.
Along with three overlapping shows, last month also brought another example of Rita's contributions to the community. Her design for the Hyatt Skywalks Memorial. The tribute has a very personal link.
Among those injured in the tragic collapse was Rita's fifth grade teacher and creative inspiration, Ruth Ann Angstead.
After they called me, I started drawing. Sometime after that, I found this drawing on the table and I looked at it and I said, this would be great for the skywalks. So I can't even remember doing this drawing. All of a sudden, I just found it on my table. I won't even try to interpret it. I feel good about it, and they feel good about it. It's uplifting. There's something about it that feels right.
The Skywalk Memorial will be installed in Hospital Hill Park at 22nd and Gillam Road. By the way, Rita Blitt's Penn Valley show runs through November 7th. The show at Longview through November 12th. All the features you see on this program are available on our website, thelocalshow.org. You can also see them on KCPT's YouTube channel. That goes for all of our weekly shows, from Week in Review to Ruckus. I'm Nick Haynes. We'll see you next time on The Local Show.
Principal funding for The Local Show provided by Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kauffman Foundation, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Hall Family Foundation, Johnson County Community College Foundation, William T. Kemper Foundation, Commerce Bank Trustee. Additional support is provided by